Francisco Salazar. They were the same people, but they were dead. Savage Land, released in 2015, co-directed and written by Phil Guidry, Simon Herbert, and David Whalen, is based on the fictional account of Francisco Salazar, portrayed by Noe Montez, who supposedly murdered the entire town of Sangre de Cristo, Arizona. His subsequent trial, and the evidence he may or may not have collected during his encounter with the unknown. While his story, trial, and the evidence is slowly revealed, the film serves as both a horror-based documentary as well as a fairly stable social commentary on the highly debated topic of immigration and border control. It is revealed early on that Francisco Salazar was accused and tried for the mass murder of the fictional town of Sangre de Cristo, Arizona. As the film develops and builds, it more and more hints at and reveals Salazar was more likely completely innocent and simply a horrified and traumatized bystander who was able to take photographic evidence of a supernatural and violent event, one that plagued and eventually destroyed everyone in the town of Sangre de Cristo. In what could have been a generalized and cliched zombie-troped film, instead we are treated to an almost unsolved mystery-esque type documentary backdrop, one that slowly and effectively unveils a set of horrific revelations in a manner that effectively begs you to suspend disbelief and enter the realistically styled malevolent world and abandon your knowledge that this is indeed fiction. We are almost never given a film shot of any monsters or entities, but we are provided with Salazar's film reel, snapped by camera as he supposedly traversed the insanity and possibly demonic-based violence that permeated the town of Sangre de Cristo on June 2nd, 2011. Resulting in 36 pictures, most of which depict a supernatural and almost demonic destruction of the town. In an interview from the Carolinian, David Whalen explains, "There were a couple of things that were almost like ground rules, and one was it has to feel real. It has to feel bigger than the world we actually have. We wanted it to be as real as possible." Along those lines, the film feels exceptionally fresh and original, within a genre bogged down by cliched zombies and demonic entities, and manages to effectively create a unique and powerful vision. We will get into the nightmarish world of Savage Land and how it manages to effectively plot and track a fictional vision that feels more and more real as the film develops, never abandoning its documentary-styled attack, one that arguably carves a definitive and original path in its depths, marking it as an extremely unique take on the genre of horror. Before we do, please hit that like and subscribe and ring that bell. I have new videos coming out all the time. And without any further ado, I present for you an analysis of Savage Land and the account of Francisco Salazar, who explains, "They were the same people, but they were dead." Plot. What we can piece together of Francisco Salazar's experience may well be lies, as nearly all law enforcement and the courts find him guilty of mass murder. But as the film develops, his story is seemingly confirmed and becomes more and more reputable. Francisco's story is mostly told by Carlos Olivares, a second-generation Border Patrol agent, portrayed by J.C. Carlos. And it does appear he has the greatest grasp on the realities of the situation. The simple facts are, on June 2nd, the town of Sangre de Cristo, Arizona, with a population of 57, was completely slaughtered in the course of one evening, with only one survivor, Francisco Salazar. The documentation on what really occurred and Francisco's tale itself is a much more detailed and complex story. Salazar's horrific account begins when his friend Danny Montez comes to his trailer, bloodied and mortally wounded, where he dies, then seemingly reanimates and attacks Salazar, who brutalizes him in self-defense, then runs north with camera in tow, documenting a horrific attack on the town of Sangre de Cristo that most probably originated in the south, as Salazar runs north through a dark plague of demonic-like beings who, although we are given no complete answers, seem to be cannibalizing the populace. However, cannibalism would be the wrong word, as defined in George Romero's epic masterpiece, The Original Dawn of the Dead. Cannibalism indicates interspecies activity, and these beings do not appear to be human, at least not anymore. And Romero himself is thanked in the credits of the film. Salazar wades through the chaos, taking various pictures as he does, all the while running north towards the church run by the Putnam family. While the courts and law enforcement argue evidence and autopsies show Salazar simply waded through the town, killing everyone with a machete and pickaxe. According to Agent Carlos Olivares, he fled north, as south was simply not an option, as it appears the attack, at least from Salazar's perspective, originated from the south. Salazar's photos, when viewed in order, almost show a map from the south end of the area to the north, as he documented his escape. Early on, he either killed Ron Templeton or sought refuge in his truck. As Salazar explains, Templeton had a gun. Templeton is physically much larger than Salazar and was indeed armed and a known expert shot. Thus, the explanation that Salazar killed him with a machete or pickaxe is a hard story to buy. Templeton's body was never found, and the photographs do show a different, much darker scenario unfolded. The curious case of the water tower presents even more evidence that Salazar was innocent. A variety of murders took place in the town's water tower, where various people fled to the top of the tower and leapt to their deaths. While there was no evidence that Salazar was ever in the vicinity of the area, therefore these deaths make little to no sense when studied within the official narrative. The Putnam family had started a church in the town, and it seems Salazar was fleeing to the church in an attempt to save them. His photography indicates a personal relationship with the family and a love for the children, of which authorities claimed was an unhealthy or voyeuristic infatuation, although the photos in no way reveal anything of that nature. The doors of the church were ripped off their hinges, which does not align with Salazar's narrative, or line up with the fact that he had been given a key by the family. At 8:19, Dwayne Putnam called Pastor Moyes and left a bizarre and horrific message, stating Grace, his daughter, was gone. He asked where is Grace, and stated only God could judge him, as only God knows what he had seen. Officially, the narrative states that Putnam had killed his family before Salazar could get to them. From the church, Salazar eventually made his way to the school, where it appears he witnessed the death of Grace Putnam. All along, he had simply been a witness to the nightmarish occurrence. But at this point, he tried to stop the malevolent entities with the flash of his camera and held on to the child's hand, as she was supposedly slain by the supernatural beasts. From here, it is not entirely clear where Salazar went, beyond heading north, and eventually finding refuge with a trucker 23 hours after the event. To state this occurs 23 hours after the event, and not 24 or a day later, seems to indicate a cultish and/or demonic activity, as the dreaded number 23 is an often used occultish number, many times making its way into internet conspiracy lore, as well as Hollywood movies and the like. The most notable, of course, being the Jim Carrey-led The Number 23. From here, Salazar was taken into custody, and eventually his roll of film was found having been left with the trucker that picked him up. He underwent two trials and was found guilty in both, and was put to death at the end of the second. On December 12, 2011, he was found guilty and executed via lethal injection in the state of Arizona. Salazar did not say one word during his trial, and at the end of his only interview, he entered a catatonic state. Forensics were done on only 7 partial corpses, as the coroner himself said he could not run DNA forensics on 20 square blocks of what was essentially gore-filled sand. Ignored in the body of evidence is the fact that Francisco Salazar's teeth don't match the victims, and he has the same marks and bites on his person that the victims do, as well as his entire roll of film being kept from the trials and not allowed as evidence, leading to his conviction and state-led death. He was buried on the northern side of the border, and his body was dug up by what locals called patriots, who were most likely bandits or angry looters desecrating his grave. He seems to have risen from death at this point, as his body goes missing, and the ending is vague, and his bite marks are often shown when his death is discussed, hinting at his possible resurrection. The ending of the film provides us with a brief but definitive attack by something caught on camera, if only for a few seconds. Was it the same band of ghouls that decimated Sangre de Cristo? Or was it a new band led by the unearthed Salazar? In the final scene of the movie, murals hinting at the resurrection of Salazar are shown, and a brief attack is shown on camera, in which it is clear, if the footage is slowed down, that Salazar is indeed alive and has become one of these malevolent beasts, indicating Salazar, even if he was no longer Francisco Salazar, is now taking his revenge upon the area and slowly moving north. Biblical influences and interpretations. Grace is Gone may well be a symbolic statement within the film, and not a definitive question of where Putnam's daughter is, but where is the grace of God in this entire process, leading credence to the theory that malevolent biblical or demonic entities were at work. Sangre de Cristo means the blood of Christ, and may well exist as a metaphor for the entities depicted in Salazar's photography to be biblical or demonic creatures. Many of the pictures do hint at more than simple zombies, more than simple monsters, but horrific and unique, long-tongued and alien-esque looking demonic figures. The fact that Salazar was a Catholic and that his destination was always a church may well lead more evidence towards a demonic occurrence or origin. The number of pictures adding up to 36 may also hint at a blatant cliche of three sixes hiding in plain sight. Although this may mean nothing, as in reality the type of film he used does contain 36 exposures, but it is an interesting number to use, and may be the reason the filmmakers chose him to only use one role. It is also interesting that Lawrence Ross filed FOIAs for 13 months, another occultish number, which may well hint at demonic activity, as well as the pre-mentioned 23 hours after, when Salazar was picked up by a trucker. What cannot be ignored is this upside-down cross on this entity, and the fact that in this cartoon, Salazar appears to be crucified upside down. Indications and clues that clearly hint, in my opinion, at demonic activity. Documentary style, feel, and perfection. The documentary feel and depiction of this film is, in my opinion, quite masterful. Effectively pulling you deeper and deeper into what feels like a non-fictional world. I found myself searching the internet for Sangre de Cristo, Arizona, and pondering just how much of this world was created, as it developed and further intertwined the horrific recollections of Salazar, and the implications of its narrative with its documentary feel. It almost always pulled me further into abandoning my disbelief, and going into a trance of what I perceived to be, even if only for the moment. The blatant truth of Salazar's story. Various maps, diagrams, and dissections of Salazar's route are shown and explained as Carlos Olivares masterfully reveals his take on what happened, and it is a much-needed breath of fresh air within a genre bogged down by a horrific amount of blood and gore, tons of zombie and demonic-based entities cannibalizing and ravaging towns, and sometimes the entire world. A genre that far too often leaves little to the imagination. Everything can be questioned, as we are truly unsure of the events. And giving us only photographic evidence and visual diagrams and maps to ponder just feels ridiculously fresh and original. Racism, immigration, and Trigger Town. The film is steeped deeply in a backdrop of racism, controversial immigration, and hatred and disdain for cultures that are either misrepresented or misunderstood. Savage Land itself is a racist name for the town of Sangre de Cristo, which is known by local Arizonians as a hotbed for drug and human trafficking. Francisco Salazar is steeped in controversy, and his past is utilized by the locals to quickly define him as a mass murderer. He is a politicized Latino man who illegally crossed the border from Nogales. He was abandoned by his father, was a drifter, and worst of all, when he was found, he was covered in tons of blood, almost none of which was his own. Some locals say he was quiet, of La Raza, the race, a group they fear came to wipe locals off the map. They call him the Cholo, defining his culture as one that glorifies death. Lawrence Ross, a writer of historical texts and fictions, plays himself. He filed Freedom of Information requests for 13 months, finally revealing nothing but the video of Francisco's interview. However, he was able to get Salazar's roll of film from the trucker that picked him up, the best and most definitive evidence we are provided. Although the cops label the evidence as being entirely faked, Lawrence decides Francisco was not crazy. What he saw was crazy. And that only two explanations exist. The occurrence was either real or staged. Lawrence eventually documents the encounter and evidence in a book entitled Painted Black, where eventually, due to fear of the unknown and fear of his reputation, he ends up blaming the race-based hatreds of the area, rather than the occurrences of supernatural origin, as the history of the area is deeply steeped in racist groups, such as the KKK, and locals are depicted as overly racist and hostile to immigrants. How a racist group could stage a full-on demonic or zombie-like attack on a town and then blame it on Francisco is beyond me. Why they would kill immigrants and locals, both of Hispanic and Anglo origin, does not fit the story either. But the cognitive dissonance of the strange situations does lend one to want to find a more rational explanation than a demon-led massacre. Sheriff John Pirano, who ran his case, is shown to be heavily racist. His attorney seems oblivious. Gus Greer, a popular radio show host, is equally oblivious. And the area in general does embrace an overly racist tone. So coming to such a conclusion does make sense. And this is exactly what Lawrence did. Reality? It is Carlos Olivares, the second-generation Border Patrol agent, that has the best idea on what took place, saying he has seen a lot of crazy things in the last 10 years, including bodies chewed by people, but no one will talk about it, and stating it is not the work of one person, stating that Lawrence Ross found the truth, but could not see it. According to Olivares, Francisco Salazar was afraid of death, and felt safer within the prison walls. Carlos believed that Francisco had 3 strikes against him. He was illegal, had a camera, and had suggestive photos of kids. It is Carlos who best tracks and defines his route through the town, and possibly the only one who analyzes the data without injecting racism or preconceived notions, taking it for what it appears to be, a documentation of a horrific supernatural event. The mass cult of cognitive dissonance. As evidence builds, people lock down further and further into their tropes of racism, and in general, silly cognitive dissonance-based takes on reality. It is an interesting phenomenon, effectively a vast majority of the people, aka a whole territory of cognitive dissonance-fueled idiots, fueled by evidence of insanity or racism. Sadly, the entire area adopts the normal or rational view of the event, despite massive and ever-mounting mountains of evidence and facts that simply do not line up with reality. In this film, as in the real world, most people fuel their take on reality with cognitive dissonance and are encouraged by the powers that be to do so. Evidence be damned. If it indicates a massive conspiracy or supernatural occurrence, they will laugh and label believers as conspiracy theorists and kooks. Sheriff John Pirano even goes so far as to say photographs are not proof, a quite absurd statement. The cult of cognitive dissonance includes Lawrence Ross, who effectively turns the entire ordeal into a racist escapade. And although there is obvious and blatant evidence and nods to racism, the actual event, when viewed through the photographs and evidence at hand, was clearly not based on racism. Although it is easier to state the KKK and the like are responsible, even though the reality of the event in question did appear to be species-based, not race-based, it is entirely ignored. AKA, whatever zombie, demon, or monstrosity that inhabited these people may well have been a different species, and black, white, red, or yellow did not matter to these beasts, as both white and Hispanic seemed equally infected and possessed by whatever dark monstrosity or plague was spreading. People were affected and turned into whatever these demonic-like entities were. It was not a case of race. It seems only after the event occurred and the evidence and story was sent to trial, it then took on a role of racism and hatred. Lovecraftian nature. While explaining a great deal and seemingly leading us directly to an obvious conclusion, vast amounts of information is left to the imagination. How these beings move, why they kill, what exactly they are, is almost all left to the imagination, beyond the 36 photographs and small hints they may well be biblical entities. It does seem one needs to be bitten or maimed to death by one of these creatures, and then they will be reborn as one. But this is only really defined when the first attack on Francisco is made by his friend Danny Montez. When Francisco explains Danny entered his home bleeding to death, died, and then came back to life, and whatever came back was no longer Danny, and whatever it was then attacked him, saying, "He was dead, and then he came after me." Almost every aspect of these monsters beyond some very small details are left entirely to your imagination. And it is here that the Lovecraftian element of the imagination is allowed to effectively plant its dark seeds in your mind. Where the beasts grow and define themselves based on your interpretation of the vague facts you are given. And this is done in an entirely masterful and refreshing way. Overall, I find this film to be horrific, extremely unique, and quite epic. The grand implications, dark music and mood, terrific photography and documentary-like nature and feel, combined with great acting, plot, and characters, all combined to make a masterpiece within the genre of horror. One that is recommended to anyone who enjoys delving into the darker side of the documentary world. Even if the subject matter and story is a work of pure fiction, it does not feel like fiction. It does indeed feel entirely real. Thank you so much for wading through the dark atrocities of Savage Land with me. Please hit that like and subscribe and ring that bell, as I have new videos coming out all the time. And until then, keep sleepwalking, my friends.